Thanks, Sarika. Two things I'd love for you to know about me before we begin. First, my lovely wife, Sarah, is here, and she is on staff with Young Life in the area. Some of you have some experience with that organization. We'd love to get to see your hand back there. That's great. We'd love to meet some of you. We haven't gotten a chance to know too many of you. We'd love to meet some of you afterwards if you don't have to run and get to be first in the lunch line afterwards. But secondly, we moved here from Florida last year, so you're going to just have to forgive my use of the word y'all sometimes. I was fighting it for a while, but it just happened, so I'm just done fighting it. It's just going to happen. So when we lived in Florida, I was teaching high school history, coaching football, and some of you know that when you're coaching football, you're wearing a headset. You're supposed to be totally tuned in to what's happening in the game. Does that make sense? You're supposed to be totally locked in. Nothing else is supposed to be entering your mind. But there was this team that we would play every year, this one team, and their crowd had this chant that they would do throughout the game every year. And for some reason, it just got me off my game. It just had me all rattled as I'm trying to coach this game. And it went like this. It was a school called Eastside High School. And someone from the East Side crowd would stand up and look at our bench, and they would say, "Who is your daddy?" And then the rest of the crowd would stand up and say, "East Side is your daddy." And the first time I heard that, I was like, okay, it's like that. And then it just kept going. "Who is your daddy? East Side is your daddy." Who? And just over and over again. And it got me off my game because it was different than anything I had ever heard before chanted by a team's crowd. And I got to thinking later, what's different about this chant? Why does that rattle me in a way that saying, like, "We will rock you," or "Scoreboard," like those kind of chants, that doesn't bother me? Why does that one get to me a little bit? And when I was thinking about it, it's because normal chants get to the level of performance. They deal with your performance. Really, when it boils down, they're really just saying, "Our team is better at this sport than your team is," or, "At the end of this game, we're going to have more points on the scoreboard than you do." That's the way most chants are, right? But this one, saying, "We are your daddy," that's taking it to another level. It just got real when you start saying that, because now it's at the level of my identity, not just my performance. You see what I'm saying? Identity is like here, performance is here. I need some head nods if you know what I'm talking about, or do I need to keep talking about this? Okay, good. All right, so identity is here, performance is here, and I'm wondering today if maybe that's why this series that y'all have been working through is so important. You guys have been talking through being made in the image of God and our identity in Christ as people were set apart for his kingdom. And today we're going to talk about another aspect of that identity. I'm really excited to talk to you about that because we're not just talking about actions anymore and performance. We're going to another level, a deeper level, a higher level, however you want to say it, but the level of our identity. And the aspect that I want to share with you today about concerning our identity is actually has everything to do with that chant that I would hear at those games. It's, it deals with the question, who is your daddy? Who is your daddy? That's what we're going to look at today. And we've already looked at the text in Ephesians chapter 1. We've heard it read, but if you do have a Bible, why don't you turn there again? We're going to spend our time there today in Ephesians chapter 1, verses 3 through 14. And we're going to explore those verses, and we're going to focus on five aspects of the part of our identity that we are adopted as children of God. That you and I are adopted as children of God. We're going to talk about five implications, five aspects of our adoption as children of God. If you're looking at the text, the first thing I want to point out is that in verses 3 through 5, we are adopted by the Father. We're adopted by the Father. Look at it again. "Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in the heavenly realms with every spiritual blessing in Christ. For he chose us in him before the creation of the world to be holy and blameless in his sight. In love, he predestined us for adoption to sonship." We are adopted by the Father. Imagine someone comes up to you today and asks you, "Hey, I've been curious. What do you mean when you say you're saved? What do you mean by that anyway? Think about how you would respond to that question. What do you mean when you say you're saved? In that discussion, is the idea that you're adopted as a child of God, is that likely to come up in your answer? For me, it wouldn't. I even went back, I had to write a paper last year for one of my classes. The title was The Sum of the Gospel. And I went back to see how many times did I mention adoption in that paper? Zero. Didn't mention it once. Well, why is that? Why is adoption, this concept that's frequently found in the New Testament, why is this not at the forefront of our mind when we think about what it means to be saved and how God blessed us in salvation? I think one reason is that even in this passage right here that we're looking at today, there are so many other blessings that come with salvation, right? I mean, we just look through the passage, we see that we're made holy, we're made blameless, we're given redemption, the forgiveness of sins. And that last one's the one that I tend to focus on. When I'm asked what it means to be saved, I'm quick to talk about, well, it means my sins are forgiven. They're not counted against me anymore. And that's kind of like where it goes, and that's where it ends. But I want us to look today and just acknowledge with one another that there's so much more to being saved than just my sins are forgiven, my debt is canceled. Those are awesome things, and there's a place to celebrate those for sure. But there are other blessings as well. Justification is not the only one. And in fact, some theologians like J.I. Packer have said that adoption, the blessing we're talking about today, is actually the highest blessing that we have as children of God. Not that it's the first blessing, not that it's the primary blessing, not even that it's the most important blessing we have, because after all, if our sins weren't forgiven, then we'd have no choice, we'd have no chance to be adopted or anything else. So it's not the primary blessing or most important, but it is the highest blessing because it's the relational one. It exists on a relational level between us and God, our Father. Think about it. If a judge declared you not guilty, that would be a great day in your life, right? That would be really relieving. But does that judge have to love you to declare you not guilty? No, he doesn't even really have to care that much about you at all to declare you not guilty. So even though you're relieved, there's something higher about hearing, you are my son, than it is to hear, you are not guilty. You see what I mean when we're saying it's a higher blessing, this blessing of adoption? And that's why I'm so excited to explore this with you today for our brief time together, because I wonder if some of you maybe have underestimated this blessing of adoption in the way that I have. So first, we're adopted by the Father. Second, we are adopted through Jesus Christ. Look at verse 5 again. He predestined us for adoption to sonship through Jesus Christ. Well, if the Father adopted us, in what sense is our adoption through Jesus Christ? I think we find the answer to that is that Jesus, our elder brother, died so that we could become part of his family. Jesus, our older brother, died so that we could become part of his family, be adopted in with him, the natural son. He's not like the elder brother in the parable of the two sons, right? Do you remember that older brother? When the younger brother went off and spent the inheritance and then wanted to come back home, how did that elder brother act? He was resentful. He didn't want the younger brother to come back in. Our older brother, the one in our family who's been given the rights of the firstborn, Jesus Christ, he died so that we could be brought back home, not just as slaves, not just as servants of the family, but as sons with all the rights that come with being sons. And it's a good thing he did. It's a good thing he did that, because otherwise, you and I are still in the orphanage, dirty, filthy, with no hope. Our only hope to get out of that orphanage, to be adopted, to join a family, and the family of God, was for Jesus to die on that cross. So first, we were adopted by the Father. Second, we saw we were adopted through Jesus Christ. Third, we're adopted in accordance with his pleasure and will. Looking at verse 5 again, he predestined us for adoption to sonship through Jesus Christ in accordance with his pleasure and will. And sure, it's God's will that I was part of his family. He wanted it to happen. But what really hits me about that part is a part, his pleasure. Do you see that there? In accordance with his pleasure, it pleased God to adopt me. Do you ever think about that? That it pleased God to bring you into the family? It's not like sometimes I think maybe we think about it in the back of our mind in this way. We picture a situation where it's like Jesus approaching the Father and being like, hey, Father, can I ask you something? I just wanted to ask you about my girl Courtney. You know, I really love her, and I was just wondering if maybe you would consider adopting her into the family. Now, before you say no, Father, I know that she just checks into chapel and sits on that right side and just texts through chapel every week. I know that. But, sorry if there's anybody named Courtney over there. I don't know anybody's name over there, so it's not, it's, you know Courtney? Okay, sorry. I'm not trying to call anybody out. So, but I know that that's the case, but I really love her, Father. So can you just kind of do me a solid here and just let her into the family this one time? And then maybe we picture the Father's like, oh, she's lucky I love you so much. Okay, let her in. All right? That's not how our Father adopted us. Our Father adopted us in accordance with his pleasure and his will. It pleased him, it delighted him to adopt us. Sarah and I have had the pleasure of several of our friends now experiencing going through the process of adopting children. And they tell similar stories about the meeting before the judge. When you stand before the judge for the adoption to be finalized, what a special moment that is for them. And the judge says something like this: do you understand that this child will belong to you as if he or she had been born to you? Do you understand that? And also, do you understand that this is absolutely final and irrevocable? And obviously, our friends who are adopting parents say, yes, I do understand. I know exactly what I'm getting into, and I couldn't be more thrilled to be doing this. Bring it on. And that's just a little taste, just the tiniest taste of how delighted our Father is in adopting us and how delighted he was to welcome us into the family. It wasn't begrudging. He delighted to do it. So we're adopted by the Father, adopted through Jesus Christ, adopted in accordance with his pleasure and will. And fourth, we're adopted to the praise of God's glorious grace. Let's look at verses 5 and 6 again. He predestined us for adoption to sonship through Jesus Christ in accordance with his pleasure and will. Verse 6, to the praise of his glorious grace, which he has freely given us in the one he loves. How does our adoption result in the praise of God's glorious grace? How does that happen exactly? Well, here we need a little background on what readers in the Roman world would read when they read this term adoption. Adoption was a little different back then. It was taken on by wealthy, childless families, and the reason that they were adopting was because they needed a son to carry on the family name. Right? And they're going to take the family inheritance and do well with it. So, unlike in our society, they didn't want to adopt infants. They actually would wait for the child to grow up, become a young man, young adult, kind of see how he's living his life, and then they'd pick out from the prospects the one who they thought would be the best fit to carry on the family name in an honorable fashion. Right? That was the way adoption usually worked in the world that Paul was writing to here. So was that God's thinking when he adopted you and I? Was he looking at us in our early years maybe and saying, oh, that one has some promise to be an exemplary child of the king? But of course we see in verse 5 that that's not what happened. He predestined us for adoption. He predestined us for adoption. In other words, it wasn't because of any promise that you and I showed to be great members of the God family. There was nothing we did in our early years to merit God's choosing us as children in his family. We could even maybe take it a step further and say that if we're talking about the orphanage and God walking around the orphanage, we were the ugliest babies, the whiniest babies, the ones that nobody wanted. And he still though we were the sickliest, picked us out and said, I want that one. That's the one I want to be my son. He did it in accordance with the riches of his grace because he felt like it. He wants to be praised for this. He wants to be praised for his grace, not for his discernment. Do you notice in verse 6, it doesn't say to the praise of his glorious discernment, as if he wants praise for being the God who walks around the orphanage and makes the best selection and really has a great keen eye to see who's going to be the great ones and who isn't. He wants to be praised for his glorious grace. So when the nations look at what God's done, when it's all said and done, God wants the nations to look and say, that must be a gracious God, because those people he picked, they had no business being members of the God family. God wants to be praised for his glorious grace as a result of adopting us. He wants to be praised for that, and we praise him for that now. And ultimately, humans and angelic powers are going to praise him together for that on the day, as was read in verse 10, when all things are summed up in Jesus Christ. So we're adopted by the Father through Jesus Christ in accordance with his pleasure and will to the praise of God's glorious grace. And fifth and finally, we are adopted, and as such, as adopted sons, we get to inherit. As adopted sons, we get to inherit. Look at the end of verse 13 into 14. When you believed, you were marked in him with a seal, the promised Holy Spirit, who is a deposit guaranteeing our inheritance until the redemption of those who are God's possession, to the praise of his glory. When our elder brother bought us membership into the family, he also bought us an inheritance. That's part of the deal. When you get to be a son, you get to inherit. We get to share in the glory of Christ. That's what our inheritance is, at least in part. And we get a little taste of it now, right? The down payment. But the real thing's to come. We get a little piece of the cake now, but we've got to wait until the whole cake is ours. That'll happen fully in the life to come. Now, some of you may have noticed something in the language I've been using throughout. And now that we've gotten to the end of the passage, it becomes really crucial. I've been talking a lot about sons and haven't really mentioned daughters. Maybe somebody who's getting offended. I don't know if you don't have to put your hand up. But sons, why not sons and not daughters? Are you some kind of sexist? And so now we got to go there, because why doesn't Paul give a nod to the daughters? Why in verse 5 does it say predestined us for adoption to sonship? Why not sonship and daughtership? What's up with that, Paul? Nobody's going to be honest about feeling that way. That's okay. But once we get to the end of the passage and we remember, verses 3 to 14 are all one sentence in the original. So this is one thought that comes together. And we see at the end of the passage that Paul has in mind a kind of sonship that results in inheritance. It becomes a little more clear. Paul's making the point when he's speaking to a world in which daughters couldn't inherit generally. He's saying, no, here's the deal. Whether you're a son or a daughter of our Father, you inherit like a son. Whether you're a son or a daughter, you inherit like a son. There's no distinction in the God family. When this works out in the end, it's going to be the same. Son, daughter, we all inherit. And so far from being misogynistic, far from being bad news and stifling to women, some of the Christian feminist authors that maybe some of you have read have seized on this passage actually as great news for women, and an example of Paul being pro-women and pointing out that the disparities of today have no place in the new heavens and the new earth. They have no place, and this inheritance is guaranteed, we see in the final verse. And that guarantee changes how we hope. There's different kinds of hope, right? You hope for things that are possibilities sometimes. You hope for things that are probabilities. Like, I've had some hopes that maybe now that we've got a new president over in the Aldine Fitness Center, we'll get some showers in there, so I don't have to smell so stank when I go to class after a workout. Anybody else ever feel that way? You guys live on campus, so you can just go home and shower. I don't, so. Maybe some of you are just hoping that this year the power won't go out in your dorm on a really cold day this winter, and you'll be miserable. Those are hopes for things that are possibilities. They're hopes for things that maybe are even probabilities. But this is a different kind of hope we're talking about here, isn't it? It's a hope in something that is a guaranteed certainty. And that changes how you feel when you hope for it. We're not just like crossing our fingers and hoping we get to inherit. We will inherit. It's a guaranteed certainty. It's happening. It's happening. So, we're adopted by the Father through Jesus Christ in accordance with his pleasure and will to the praise of God's glorious grace, and we get to inherit. Two implications of what we've talked about, and then I'll close. First, if you've been adopted by the Father through Jesus Christ in accordance with his pleasure and will to the praise of God's glorious grace, and you've got an inheritance waiting for you in full, you're going to want to savor this truth. This truth that we've looked at today, it's on a higher register even than the truth that you've been declared innocent by the judge. It's on a higher level even than that. So let yourself rejoice in that. I know that you hear so many sermons and lessons here, and it's got to be a battle. It's got to be a fight to let each one soak in. I know it. But fight for it. Fight to let this one soak in, that you are a child of the King. Maybe when you're not feeling it, look yourself in the mirror and say, who is your daddy? God the Father is your dad. There's got to be a two-syllable way to say that, but I couldn't think of one. Fight to let this truth sink in. Second implication, if you are adopted by the Father through Jesus Christ in accordance with his pleasure and will to the praise of God's glorious grace, and you've got an inheritance waiting for you, you will start living like your daddy. You will start acting like your daddy. It'll happen. It just will happen. Listen, I'm not telling you, hey, leave here today and live like daddy, although I wouldn't be wrong to be saying that. But in keeping with the tone of this passage that's not exhorting us to do anything, I just want to say it's going to happen. Look at verse 4. He chose us in him before the creation of the world to be holy and blameless in his sight. That's what's wrapped up in becoming a son of our heavenly Father. You'll start looking like your daddy. You will. Jesus said, sons of Abraham, act like Abraham. Sons of the devil, act like the devil. Sons of God, act like God. And that will happen in increasing measure as you press more and more into this reality that you are an adopted son of God the Father. Don't be surprised when it happens. It's not something strange that's happening to you. It's just what happens when you become part of the God family. Friends, do you know who you are? You're a child of our Heavenly Father. You've been given his name. You've been given the right to cry, Abba, Father, in your prayers to a personal God who loves you dearly. That God, that Father, is going to provide for you. He's going to protect you. Yes, he'll discipline you, but he will never, ever cast you off. One day you're going home to be with your family in intimate fellowship forever. And who's in that family? Well, your Savior is your older brother, and he died so that you'd come in. And everybody in this room who's a Christian is your brother and sister, and we're going to get to celebrate our family relationship forever and ever. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in Christ with the gift of adoption to sonship.